welcome to another edition of City Beat TV. I'm your host, Lakia Stanton, and today we have the pleasure of speaking with three gentlemen who were a part of a very significant historical period in the United States. We're going to talk about the impact that that period has had on the United States in present day, as well as the impact that it's had on their lives. We have Mr. Eugene Bryce, Richard Tyrell, and Tony Francis in the studio today, and each of them is going to share their story as well as their current views on that period. Without further ado, gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you
for having us here.
Absolutely, absolutely. So you guys were a part of the Vietnam War.
Yes.
A very, as I said in the intro, very significant historical period in the United States. What was that like? And we'll start with you, and I'll keep it open-ended just like that. What was that experience like for you?
First of all, it was an experience that I was too young to understand. All I knew was I was drafted, and I was told that you're going or not going. I decided to go in, and I had my basic training and my AIT training and I had specialized training. But then they told me I was going to a place called Vietnam, which I had heard very little about. But I knew I had no issues with them, personal issues with them. But that's where we were going to Vietnam. And I was going on a year tour. And I wasn't excited about it, but I took the challenge.
You took the challenge.
Took the challenge and I went.
Mr. Tyrell, what was it like for you?
I joined the Marine Corps. I volunteered for enlistment. Well, somewhat volunteered for enlistment. A judge gave me some assistance there. And as an 18-year-old kid in the infantry, initially was quite shocking. I mean, frightening is really a small word to use sometimes. And a lot of different experiences, a lot of personal growth. The issues that we dealt with as individuals in an infantry platoon were dealing with the issues of society only 30 men at a time. So it's the human experience and the combat experience. And I say that because the great compassion I'm sure that all of us experienced in Vietnam from the men that we worked with and the terribly violent necessity that comes about when men go to war.
Yeah. Wow. Mr. Francis.
Yes, just like Richie, I enlisted in the Army. The men in my family, they fought in World War I, in World War II, in Korea, and this was the war of my generation. So, beyond unwise, I enlisted. I graduated from Officer Candidate School when I was 20, so I was young. When I got to Vietnam, I was 21, and not until that time did I realize how much responsibility I had in that situation. And like Richie said, I think maybe I was too young. You know, when you have 40 lives entrusted to you. And I learned that war is not a game. I learned that it's not a great adventure. I can tell you it's not fun. But on the other side of it, I think in the positive vein, it was a good experience that helped me grow up. But when I came home with all the racial things that was going on and how I was treated in the service, I came home very bitter. Very, very, very bitter.
Yeah, I want to explore that actually a little bit more. You know, you guys are fighting a war abroad and then coming home and having to fight a war at home.
Well, that war started for us. The home war started while we were at war.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? We were fighting a war against our so-called enemy, the Viet Cong and NVA. We were also fighting an enemy who was sitting right next to me, in my dorm, in my daily operations. I mean, so we were fighting a war of the known and a war of the unknown at the same time. And I say that because during the time that Martin Luther King got killed, We all were in combat at that time. And we could walk through the jungles and see Life magazine pictures posted on trees. Not by us, but by the enemy, saying, black brothers, your war is not here. Your war is back home. And that played a hell of a mind game on you, because they were right. They were right. Our war wasn't there. Our war was back here. And like when we got back here, it really showed us our war was back here all the time. You know, so when we left Vietnam, our war had just begun. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Physically, we might have came back physically somewhat together, but mentally we were destroyed. And I say that it's because we were all young men and women. We were all young and young. I have an article here that I wrote, Stars and Stripes, and got this article here. And it was an article that was written by one of the top Stars and Stripes reporters. And he did it on my unit. And it says here, GI smash VC assault. They don't talk, and they also talk about the 112 of us, that 28 of us got killed that night, another 64 got wounded. And that left what we had here. And we were attacked by an enemy size of unknown size. And along with my white brothers, we fought side by side until we fought the enemy off. But we lost so many men. But the next morning, I looked at my white brothers and said, we made this. And that's when I became tight with my white brothers and my Spanish brothers, my Indian brothers, because I knew we were one. And we needed each other to get out of there alive. And there was no more joking. No, we needed each other to get out of there alive. And it never could be more true than this battle right here. So, you know, that's when I grew up. As 18-year-old, I grew up and became a man overnight there. And I really began to appreciate those who were around me. And Richie and I are so close. I mean, we are like brothers. And Tony and I, our career has gone together, side by side. He was my commander, I was his platoon sergeant. He was my company commander, I was his first sergeant. So we kind of hold on to each other. And we become therapists for each other.
What was it like for you coming back to a home war, if you will, having experience with your...
I had a very unique homecoming, but I'd like to address another issue, and that was racism within Vietnam. In the Marine Corps, a lot of the long-term career Marines were from the Deep South, and a lot of the young men, black and white, didn't get along with them. But the young African-American men who came from the Deep South, many of them, their only contact with a white person was always negative. And as a result, there was a bonding that we had to develop within the unit, between him and I, you know, as two human beings, to understand that we were there for each other, that he knew he could trust me, that I had his back, you know. And having grown up here in Springfield, and I grew up on Green Street, I went to all integrated schools, any parent on my block could kick my butt. And if I went home and said, Mom, Mrs. Coyote hit me, bang, I got banged from Mom, because she knew Mrs. Coyote would never hit me for no reason. So, I mean, to having grown up in that environment, that sense of community, I still to this day feel we have a responsibility, all of us, to work towards that sense of community so that all of us feel it. You know, it can't be just a comfort zone. It's got to be living. It's like the bumper sticker that says, for those who fought for it, freedom has a flavor the protected will never know. Mm. And that's because we know the cost of it. We know that this young black man who grew up in the ghettos of Washington, D.C., died beside this young kid from Roslindale, Mass., and this French immigrant from New York, you know. And we knew that, and we have to get the rest of the world to understand that we have to, as a human race, stand together.
See, because, you know, our mission really began when we took our uniform off. And our mission became then is not, we no longer world police. We became our community police. But we're not being used properly. You know, we have some veterans in this community who are very, very strong. And some of us work hard. Some of us are ignored. And community leaders in this community, for some reason, have a way of breaking us up. They have a way of just kind of tearing us apart because they see unity there. And people don't like to see success. They don't like to see brothers and whites. I don't understand that. But I've experienced that over and over again. With people in this community, our so-called leaders in this community, I mean, you can't get them to work for do anything for veterans. I've worked for veterans since I retired from the Army in 1996 and never received not one paycheck. And I must put in at least 80 hours a week just working for veterans and their families. You couldn't give me a paycheck. Because my mission is to help those veterans and their families. That's my mission. I was lucky enough to retire. Good pension. Retired from the city and from the Army. So pretty much okay. But I know a lot of veterans out there who are not okay. So my mission is to help them. And we all share the same goal. It's to help those who are unable to help themselves.
Absolutely.
As well as their families goes.
Right. So fast forward to today. We're no longer fighting, or at least we're not calling it a civil rights movement, but we have this whole new movement, Black Lives Matter. What does that mean to you, considering your experience? And I'd like to start with Mr. Francis.
I think that the movement is nothing new. We're just going through cycles, and this is a new cycle that's been embraced by a lot of young people, which is important. And we should be there to support them, and vice versa, they should want to listen to what we have to say because we've been through that before. So we can give them some good advice. And like Gene says, people look past us. You know, they don't think we have something worthwhile to give them. I wish they would say Black Lives Matter too. I think that would end a lot of the controversy that's going on about the name. I don't know if you're aware of it, but they tried to get that designated as a terror group. They had something like 140,000 people sign the petition. And I don't know where it stands now.
Online petition.
Yeah.
God bless them.
But it's important. Things haven't changed.
No.
And what's sad is we're catching it on video now, when before we couldn't see it that way. And people who don't look at us like us, they see it differently.
Mm-hmm.
And all these policemen, whether they white, black, Hispanic, Indian, or whatever, they're getting off with it. And it's clearly, you know, here's the difference. Someone tried to tell me, well, black people are killing more of themselves than the policemen. But the ones who's killing us off in our communities are criminals. The policemen took an oath to serve and protect. And they putting us in a vice grip because we got the gangbangers on one side and then we have the policemen on the other side and we caught in the middle. And I think if you talk to the average black man, they do not trust policemen at all. I think most black men do this with their sons. They tell them, if a policeman stops you, you be polite, don't resist, get to the police station. When you get there, give me a call. And don't do anything crazy.
Absolutely.
So that's what you have to teach your young boys or your young men, because they don't understand this yet. A lot of them don't understand it. So I think it's important. And they get that from whom? The older people. I know when I was coming up, old people didn't know anything.
No.
I'm serious. They didn't know what was going on.
So we
to
thought.
Us.
Right.
You know, but I want to go back to something Gene said that needs to be revisited is the racism that was out there in the street and the racism that was in the military. And the point you get to is, like, aren't we all fighting together? Aren't we all in this together? So why do I have to be isolated and then be punished or treated differently and being disrespected because of my complexion? Now, I grew up in New York City, in Harlem. Nothing but black people. So I wasn't prepared to deal with that racism. When I went to Officer Kennedy School, we were taught the mission, the mission, the mission, the mission. We weren't taught about these politics and be aware of all these things that happen around us. And most of the units I served in may have had one or two black officers in a battalion. That's like 200 and 500 men, 700 yeah. men. Mm-hmm. And my experience, my first company commander was from Georgia. My second one was from Mississippi. My third one was from Alabama. My fourth one was from South Carolina. And the one that treated me the best was from Maryland. But I would, being naive, I would not think, I didn't think, that people would waste so much time to ensure that I would fail. Why would they do that? That's irrational.
You know, and it was so obvious that we were set up, because they put Tony and I together, so we'd fail together. I mean, it was a setup. It was a setup. They put us together, and they kept us together, from a platoon sergeant to the first sergeant and company commander. They don't have, that doesn't happen. But they said they're going to fail. They're going to make them fail together. Well, we turned the clock on them. Hmm. We were the best in the battalion, the best in the brigade, the best in the division. So, and they didn't like they did not like that, because we found a way to get our men to respect us, white, black, and Hispanic, to respect us, and we respected them. And we treated them like men and like women, and we got along very well. And so they found other ways to block us, holding promotions back, passing over us for promotions. And so, and we still fight today. I mean, that was, you know, we're still fighting the war today, you know, to get recognition, to get proper, treatment, to get our benefits proper, get proper benefits. I mean, we all have to fight. And it's not just blacks are fighting. Our young white brothers are fighting as well to get those same skills, to get those same deeds that they so well deserve. And we have to fight every day, every single day, to get those things met. Minds are met. Like I said, I know a lot of brothers who are still fighting. My job is to help them get theirs. Whatever it takes.
You know what, Gene? Look how long it took us to get out there.
I know it. 30 years, 40 yeah. years.
I came home in 1970, and I really just got into the process in 1995.
Right.
That's crazy.
Yep. Why is that? What are we missing in America?
We, black, white, Hispanic, it didn't matter. When we came home from Vietnam, each one of us individually had great feelings of alienation from our families. I mean, my grandmother used to call me her little Frankie. When I came home from Vietnam and she called me her little Frankie, this thing inside of me said, oh, if she only knew what her little Frankie has done. Mm-hmm. You know, and these are self-imposed, perhaps, but so there was an ingrained negative feeling about myself. And then you add on the social rejection that came to so many of us. You just felt totally out there alone on an island. And until we as veterans started to talk to each other, work together. The first veterans group in Springfield, Massachusetts was the Winchester Square Vietnam Era Vets. And all of us were involved in that. And it gave us as a group of veterans a voice together. And that's when people started to pay attention, when we stood together.
Right.
You know what, Richie?
But as long as they could keep us separated, divided,
right.
it
divided
worked
time.
For them.
Right.
But when we joined forces, yeah. it worked for us.
Wow. Yeah.
And that's what Black Lives Matter. And that's what we have to get our, but we can't win people over with slogans. We have to win people over one person at a time.
Absolutely.
That's
speaking
right.
to them, getting them to understand that, you know, if an 18-year-old kid in Long Meadow is stopped for a traffic stop, they're not going to search the car for drugs. If an 18-year-old kid up here on Eastern Avenue gets stopped for a traffic stop, they're going to ask permission, perhaps ask permission, within the law to search the vehicle. You know, and those are the kind of contrasts that we as a society have to stop.
Yeah.
You know, that's why Black Lives Matter, because of the great difference. Where do we begin?
But you know, I look at it like this, Tom, and they said one person at a time, one step at a time. When I was 18 years old, I was given the responsibility, and Tony had more responsibility than any of us, but I was given the lives of 12 men. And said, Bryce, you're going on a patrol tonight, and these 12 men are yours. You're taking them out of here in good shape, bring them back the same way. And that's 18 years old. That's a hell of a responsibility at 18 years of age, when I'm just as scared as they are. You know, but they gave us a mission, and the mission was to do what the order says. And that's what we did. But I also knew that it was a lot more than just taking them out on patrol. They had to trust me, I had to trust them. We had to bond, we had to be a strong bond there so that we can all feel that no one would be left behind. No matter what color, whatever, you would not be left behind. And I had to get my men to believe that if they fall, I'll be there to catch them. Don't worry, just fall. One of us will catch you. And they had to believe that.
I don't think people realize how close that you get in a combat situation.
Yeah.
Really?
I mean, I don't care what you look like at that bottom level, people are like this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you don't find that out here in the streets.
Right.
So even by virtue of that, you feel alone and isolated because you're embraced. If guys went out on patrol to set up for the night, we would take their ponchos and make a shelter for them so when they came back, they'd have a dry place to sleep. You know, if somebody had one beer, you gonna make sure everybody there got a sip out of
that one can.
Out of that one can. I mean, that's how it was. And a report came out maybe no more than a month or so ago where they said what added to the PTSD that Vietnam vets were experiencing is because they lost that closeness.
Yes.
And they worry about the guys. We came home by ourselves, not as big groups like they do today. And you take telephone numbers and addresses and I'm gonna stay in touch with you, but you don't do it. And the reason you don't do it, you don't wanna call their home and find out they didn't make it. So we didn't stay in touch with each other because of that. So now you're out here in society and they're telling you how the war is. Mm. Oh, I know you were, everybody was getting high over there. Or this was going on. I said, do you really think that when you're out there in the boondocks, that you're gonna be getting your head bad when you know there's people crawling around there to kill you? That doesn't make sense. Maybe you do that in the rear.
Right.
Yeah.
In more secure places.
No.
But you're not gonna do it out there. I'm gonna tell you that. You're not gonna, plus you can smell it.
Yeah.
You know, they tell you not even to put deodorant and cologne on. Because they don't wear it. So they move in the area, they start getting these nice fragrances that the Americans are right over there.
Wow.
That's where they are.
Yeah, we can smell that ivory soap.
Wow. So one thing that I've been hearing or gathering from all that you guys have been saying, and again, you know, really, we're trying to understand why society, even after 50 years, is still needing a Black Lives Matter, still needs a movement. And, you know, and it sounds like in order to overcome what we're facing in America and really all over the world in some capacity is unity. The last time that I felt that America came together was around 9/11. That was, we found something that we could all agree
gather
on across racial lines, but it was still centered on some form of war.
Right.
What is your take on that? Like, why is that? Why does it appear that war or trouble or some type of threat has to be the thing that allows or gathers people together?
You look at our politicians. Some of them don't show up until the problem is over, or until the problem happens.
Right.
What happened to the pre? Mm-hmm. What happened to all the pre stuff we're supposed to be doing here, as community folks, community leaders? Why don't we get involved before this stuff happens?
Right.
You know, they only show up when the ball is rolling off the table. And I'm saying, hey, it's too late then. Because when I started training my squad, these guys were raw. And I knew in order for me to make them effective and successful, mm-hmm. I had to have them in the palm of my hand, and we had to work together. And I couldn't wait till the war started to do this. We had to do it now. So what we do out here, we wait till something happens.
Right.
Oh, we got to change this. We got to do this. We got to do that. Well, it's too late.
So we have to be more proactive.
Absolutely.
In general.
We have to remember that we're one society.
Right.
You know, and we don't seem to remember that until some great tragedy strikes.
Right.
And we also put Band-Aids on things.
Yeah.
We don't solve it. We don't solve it. That's why you can just keep repeating the same problems over and over again through a cycle.
Wow.
I think one of the things that when it's a black-white relationship, mm-hmm. I think one of the things that white folks have to do is they have to own what they did. They have to acknowledge that something happened to us.
Right.
You know, that makes a difference. One of the things that I express to people is don't let them define who you are.
Define.
The only person that can define you is yourself.
Awesome.
So, you know, they'll say blacks aren't graduating to the same numbers as white folks. But most white folks don't realize that it was against the law for about 300 years for black people to know how to read or write.
Right.
So I said, if they say 20%, it used to be 0%, that's an improvement.
Yeah.
I had some students from Pakistan. They were top students in their nation. Their government sent them over here. I'm a Muslim. So they wanted me to teach them and how it is to function as a Muslim in a plural society.
Right.
But when I told them about, because they wanted to know about the black experience, that we were not allowed to read or write, they couldn't believe that. Get out of here.
Yeah, it's real. Yeah, and that's what we've, you know, face, and it's just really all about context and really trying to, as much as possible, get the full story. And that's what we are starting to do, you know, even with opportunities like this to get you guys to educate the public about not only historical occurrences, but how it impacts them today and why it's still relevant today. You know, so this is just the beginning.
Sure.
We want to certainly invite you guys back, and we want to bring others on to continue to educate the public about these things. So I want to thank you for your time and for
it's
all the
pleasure.
Information. And I look forward to, you know, talking with you guys real soon.
Thank you very much.
That was City Beat TV. There's a lot of information out there. It's important that you take the time to research, ask questions, and find out for yourself what's really happening in the world around you. And then with that information, take it and do something with it. I'm your host, Lakia Stanton. Another segment of City Beat TV. We're out.